Welcome to Connie Martinson Talks Books. Once upon a time, there was a castle in the middle of New York City called The Plaza. And in The Plaza, there was a nightclub that was really a very special place to come for the beautiful people. Well, who were they and who was there? The book is called The Persian Room Presents, and it's an oral history by those who were the performers, the stars. It's written by my guest, Patty Farmer, and it's published by Vantage Press. Welcome, Patty.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Thank you for inviting me.
Well, to read this book, it's like going back, as I said, once upon a time. From 1934 to 1975, The Persian Room was it.
Absolutely.
Now, did you ever go there during that period?
No, it was just before I was legal. So.
Yeah. But it was, the place was really beginning with a woman named Hildegard. Hildegard was the sort of woman everyone was sure that she was European, and she wasn't.
Nope.
And she wore long gloves. And her favorite song was what, Darling, Je Vous Aime Beaucoup?
Yes, yes, you know your musical history.
Yeah. Now, how did you find out her history?
Well, I did research. You know, I don't know if you know, but I did not set out to write a book. When I started this magical journey, I wanted to find out the history of the Plaza Hotel. The Plaza had just celebrated its 100th birthday in New York in 2007. And I thought, you know, anyone who's been around or anything who's been around for 100 years has a lot of history going on.
We should say it closed for a while it was converted from hotel to condominium, but it still has some hotel rooms.
It's predominantly
and
hotel still.
You're one of the fortunate ones who has a condominium there.
Yep.
Yeah. So as you started to do the history, what did you discover?
Well, you know, I talk to people, and that's one thing I love to do. You know, I talk to the doormen. There are some doormen that have been there for 40, 45 years, and they would, you know, tell me different stories. That they mentioned this room, this Persian room, nightclub. You know, so I heard that, and I asked other people, and it piqued my interest. And I went to the hotel management, and I said, can I hunt around your archives? You know, I've heard about this Persian room, and I'm fascinated. I want to know more. And they looked at me, Connie, like I had green hair.
Yeah.
And they said, archives? We have no archives.
Yeah.
And I said, you're kidding me. This hotel's been around 100 years, and you have no history, no archives, no photographs? They said, the photographs we have are the ones on the wall, and that's it. They said, we've had a lot of owners, from Conrad Hilton to Donald and Ivana Trump, and everybody took with them what they wanted when they left.
Yeah.
And I thought this was terrible. So I put together a research team, and we hunted through the City of New York Museum and Library and many, many different places and got the history.
I'm holding up the picture of Marge Champion. And she was really quite young when she was started to dance and perform there.
Absolutely, but you know what? She doesn't look too much different now at 94.
Well, she was just on stage, and we were talking about it 2 weeks ago for the Gypsies or the Dancers event that they had at the Hilton.
Right, absolutely. Yeah. The day I had the pleasure of being invited to Marge's home, she had just come back. This was in New York, and she had just come back from the West Coast visiting the Walt Disney Studios and putting on an exhibition, a dance exhibition. And she was like 93.
Well, you know, people forget she was Snow White.
Can you imagine?
Yeah. And then, of course, she married Gower Champion, and they had for a period of time, a very good relationship.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah.
And to give you some idea of the high esteem, not only the audience, but also the performers held of the Persian Room, Marge told me she and Gower had just been married. I mean, like a week, and they were getting ready to go on their honeymoon, and heard that they could perform at the Persian Room opening for Liberace, and they gave up their honeymoon.
Yeah.
They said, you know, we would absolutely rather be at the Persian Room opening up for Liberace than anywhere else.
And it's interesting because Liberace in those days was not quite the flamboyant Liberace that we think of.
Nope, not in the beginning.
He
was actually an intermission pianist for a while at the Persian Room.
He also was really quite a classical pianist. And wasn't it somebody at the Persian Room who put on the candelabras on his piano?
That was the first time that trademark was exhibited. And it was so innovative and new that it, you know, obviously became his trademark.
Interesting that the first sort of, cougar is Celeste Holm, whom you spoke to. And she was, 87 when she got married to him?
Right, to Frank.
And he was like 48 or something.
Mm-hmm.
And they're still married, still alive.
I had lunch with them last week, and they're very much in love and just actually a perfect pair.
How does she look?
She looks wonderful. She still has those vibrant, beautiful eyes that just command your attention.
It was interesting how you've done the book into decades.
Mm-hmm.
And who was there in which decade, and although you couldn't do them all, how they sort of like changed with the times.
Absolutely. The 30s, when the Persian Room opened, you know, 1934, it was predominantly dance teams.
Burns and Allen, I'd never seen this picture of them before.
Yes, they were there. I mean, there's almost you'd have a better chance naming or trying to guess who wasn't there than who was there. Everybody was there. That was the epitome of having made it in New York.
And, of course, in those days, people wore black tuxedos and ties, and the women wore long dresses. It was quite a time.
It definitely was. The women had their hair done and pulled out the best jewelry and put on their best manners, too,
to go. Now we're into, the 50s with Diane Carroll?
The first time Diane was there was the late 50s, and she continued to perform quite often into the 60s.
And this is Clive Davis who's with her.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right. And Diane told me an amusing story. In the 50s, she did not have her daughter yet, but, you know, she had her daughter in her, in the 60s, not in Diane's 60s. And when the performers performed at the Persian Room, they stayed at the Plaza. And she was performing so much at the Plaza that her young daughter grew up thinking the Plaza was her home, not just a place that she stayed. But and she actually became coined by the staff there as the Black Eloise.
We should say there's a picture here of Kate Thompson, which we'll talk about later, but she was the one who created Eloise, and apart from being also a phenomenal performer and the woman who had trained Judy Garland and all of the MGM stars, she was a performer there as well.
Mm-hmm. Quite often. And actually, your viewers might be interested to know that her backup singers were the Williams boys, the Williams brothers.
Yeah.
And this was before one of the Williams brothers, Andy Williams, was the solo crooner we all have come to know.
But he was also, having read about Kate Thomas in Sam Irwin's book, he was also her boyfriend.
Absolutely, and that didn't come out till just recently.
Was it that much of a secret?
I think it was. There were some people that were close to them that had their suspicions from people that I've spoken to, but everybody was pretty close mouth about it.
And she did not pay well, and also because we've mentioned Eloise, Hillary, who was the artist cartoonist who developed Hillary, she didn't want to give him any credit.
No.
She said, I paid you, I don't need,
And she kept all the artistic control. And Hillary told me, Eloise was born in the Persian room because that's where he met Kay Thompson.
Yeah.
You know, when she was thinking of collaborating with somebody, she said, you know, well, hell, if Hillary come over and catch the end of my show and we'll talk after the show. So
yeah.
Hillary says, Eloise was born in the Persian room and raised in the plaza.
What's so interesting too is Kay used to use that little voice when she talked to friends on the phone. And it was somebody who said, listen, why don't you write a children's book with that story?
It definitely was, which I think it's a little annoying, that little voice, but that's what it ended. And whenever she was in trouble, she'd resort to her little Eloise voice, you know, saying, I'm only 6 years old, you know, don't be mad at me.
Uh-huh.
And it turned into a historic children's book that's known the world over.
And, of course, wonderful Connie Stevens here with Eddie Fisher, who at least she said she has two daughters from. And, of course, it was Hawaiian Eye that she started at Warner Brothers. And my husband did direct quite a few of those when she was Cricket.
Cricket Blake, right? That's right.
Did you spend much time with Connie?
Connie invited me to her house here in Beverly Hills and was just so gracious. She was getting ready to head out the following day.
To Branson or something?
No, I think she was directing something about, it escapes me at the moment, but she was doing a big project and still made time to share her stories about the Persian room, and they were hysterical. They were
one of the sharpest businesswomen, too, in the city.
Absolutely.
Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But it's interesting because Connie was not someone you would have thought of in connection with the Persian room. It was more you'd think of Hildegard before Connie.
I was trying to get an interview with Connie, and when I approached certain people that knew her and managers, they said, well, Connie never performed at the Persian room. And I said, no, she did perform at the Persian room. They said, no, she never performed at those small intimate venues, always the big Las Vegas shows. And I said, you know, could you ask her?
Yeah.
You know, and of course, Connie came back and said, yeah, I was at the Persian room and it was great fun. Yeah. And had, as I said, some funny stories to tell.
And of course, wonderful Carol Lawrence and Robert Goulet, which did they both perform at the Persian room?
They both performed numerous times separately, of course.
Yeah.
Yes. And Carol, well, her nightclub act was proclaimed by Ed Sullivan as the best nightclub act he had ever seen.
Really?
It was, and the next day, you couldn't get tickets for her run there.
Yeah.
It was sold out.
And, of course, Goulet, he had to have the ladies there swooning.
Yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Now, who was the one who said, there's an elephant in this room tonight. I'm not supposed to even say his name. And there in the corner was Cary Grant.
That was Carol Lawrence. And the way that happened was the Persian room was the type of place, kind of like you think about Las Vegas, where after performers did their show, they'd grab their friends and they'd head over to the Persian room to catch a late show.
Yeah.
Or they'd go there on their nights off, or if they weren't making a movie, they'd head there. So every single night, the maitre d' would hand the performer a list of people that had to be recognized. You know, and this particular night, he said to Carol, you know, we have all these people in the audience, and you have to acknowledge them. And, oh, you're so lucky. Today, we also have Cary Grant, but you can't recognize him because he's going to sit in the small little corner by the door and just be a little, you know, fly on the wall and watch the show.
Yeah.
And if things get too hot for him, he'll be close to the door that he can escape being mobbed. So you mustn't mention him. So Carol's doing her show and comes to the point where she says, oh, you know, and I want to acknowledge, you know, Ethel Merman is here and so-and-so is here. And then she took a moment, she told me, and she said, She just went for it. Yeah. She said, you know, we all know there's an elephant in the room, and I'm not supposed to mention this elephant, but how can I not? You know, he's one of my favorite people of all times, and Mr. Cary Grant. And she said, from, you know, way back in the corner, she saw him stand up and take his napkin and put it down forcefully on the table and said, you know, well, I never, you know, and she was sure he was going to just leave by that door that he was very close to, but he didn't. And he walked all the way to the stage and the audience went wild and stood up. I mean, this was the height of his popularity. And she put on her best Fanny Brice voice and said, oh, you're gorgeous. And he bent her over and gave her this gigantic kiss and said, right back at you. And she said she almost couldn't speak. It was...
The shows these people put on were an hour long. No intermission, no break. They had to really work hard and have it well choreographed.
They did. They did, and many of them were very, very energetic shows. You know, we were talking about Carol. Mm-hmm. She put on a show on a 10-foot ladder that her dancers spun her around, and she sang and danced on this 10-foot ladder. I mean, it was quite a show.
And the room only held 250 people.
And it was a no raised stage. They performed on ground level with the tables.
And, you know, it's so hard to think of today in the way we look at, you know, a Staples Center or something on that order for performing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think that was eventually what changed the scape, you know, the landscape of nightclubs. You know, in New York, we had Madison Square Garden open and being able to hold the large crowds and the entertainers, if they could put on one show versus two shows a night for 7 days a week, you know, many of them opted to do that.
Interesting, too, is the generations, because you have a picture in the beginning of Eddie Duchin, and then years later, his son, Peter Duchin, who now lives up in Santa Fe, New Mexico, as well as New York. Mm-hmm. And, of course, here is Peter playing the piano.
That is interesting how he not only followed in his father's footsteps musically, but also in the great venues like this.
Yeah. He must have been towards the end before it closed.
Very much so.
Yeah.
Right? I think it was, he played there, it was a New Year's Eve party. It might have been 1971, right around then.